Okay, everyone, good morning. Today we are going to continue with our book club on the fundamentals of diagnostic radiology. Today we'll talk about the chapter about the adrenal glands and the kidneys, presented by your colleague, Dr. Hiba. She may start.
Good morning. I will start with the main indication of imaging of the adrenal gland. First of all, it is important to provide non-invasive character of the accidentally found adrenal mass to detect whether it is a malignant or benign non-functioning adenoma. About 5% of patients who undergo multi-detector CT scan of the abdomen for another cause, no non-primary, there's accidental adrenal gland will be discovered. Second, patient with non-malignancy, especially lung cancer, in order to detect metastatic disease. And third, in patient with adrenal endocrine syndrome, diagnosed clinically to detect whether it is due to adrenal hyperplasia or adrenal adenoma, because the treatment of both are different completely. Multi-detector CT scan, PET CT, ultrasound, scintigraphy, adrenal vein sampling, and image-guided adrenal biopsy, all these are imaging method of adrenal gland. Start with the anatomy of the adrenal gland. The adrenal gland located within the perirenal space surrounded by fat. The right adrenal gland located posterior to the inferior vena cava when entering the liver, between the right cross of the liver, the right cross of diaphragm and the right lobe of the liver. While the left adrenal gland, right medial and anterior to the upper lobe of the left kidney, posterior to the pancreatic and splenic vessel. On cross-sectional imaging, normal adrenal gland, it appears as soft tissue density on CT and ultrasound of V or inverted U shape, Y shape. Each limb of a smooth outline and uniform thickness, it's about 4 to 5 centimeter length and up to 7 millimeter thickness. On T1, it appears hypo-intense or equal to striated muscle. On T2, it appears iso to hypo-intense on to the liver and hypo-intense to the spleen. This is the normal adrenal gland seen on multi-detector CT scan. This is the right adrenal gland and this is the left adrenal gland of uniform thickness and normal size. This is on MRI, the normal adrenal gland of inverted V or Y shape. Chemical shift artifact is used to demonstrate if there is intracellular fat to detect a drop of signal in out of phase and used to determine the fat content in adenoma, while fat saturation MR technique is used to determine macroscopic fat that is seen in myelolipoma, also showing loss of signal on fat saturation. Incidental adrenal mass in patients without non-malignancy, most small, less than 4 cm adrenal nodule are benign, non-hyperfunctioning adrenal cortical adenoma. Less than 3% of these are malignant. While in patients with non-malignancy, the incidence of metastasis to the adrenal gland rise to 50%. These lesions are just as important to characterize in order to provide accurate tumor staging. Adrenal cortical adenoma, it is the most common adrenal mass found in 4 to 6% of population with increased incidence with increased age. 94% of these adenoma are incidentally found truly incidentally found, and approximately 6% of adenoma secrete excess hormone and cause clinical or subclinical manifestation of adrenal endocrine syndrome. Fat accumulation found in 70% of adenoma and result in lipid-rich adenoma. Other 30% are termed as lipid-poor adenoma. Attenuation of adenoma on an enhanced CT between minus 20 to 30 Hauss field units. Enhancement on post-contrast, usually unpredictable, could be heterogeneous. Benign adenoma characterized on multi-detector CT by rapid washout of contrast agent. This is an incidental finding, incidentaloma, of right adrenal mass measuring 30 by 70 millimeter nodule. And on here, the density of it measuring 6.9 Hauss field unit. Adrenal metastasis exceedingly common and found in 27% of autopsy series. A smaller lesion less than 4 cm usually tend to be homogeneous, well-defined, difficult to distinguish from benign non-functioning adenoma. on a CT scan and MRI, lesion larger than 4 cm generally show characteristic of malignancy, including non-homogeneous density, irregular shape, thick irregular margination, internal hemorrhage and necrosis, and invasion of the adjacent structure. Usually metastasis come from lung, breast, melanoma, gastrointestinal tumor, thyroid and renal cancer. Stability of the lesion over a period of time, this will recognize cause feature of benign adenoma. Absence of change in size and appearance over 6 to 12 months is accepted as evidence also of benignancy. Stability of the lesion over 1 to 2 years is a confidence of benign lesion. Increase in size or change in the configuration of the lesion over 6 months is an indication of malignant tumor. Multi-detector CT is the imaging modality of choice. 70% with lipid rich adenoma demonstrated by attenuation less than 10 Hausfeld unit, and the lesion should be measured at the center of the lesion, and the area of hemorrhage and necrosis should not be included, and called the range of interest, and the attenuation larger than 10 Hausfeld unit, it is detected as indeterminate lesion and needs further investigation. Percentage washout measurement is very important to detect whether it is benign or not. As in benign adenoma, there is absolute washout percentage of more than 60%, while relative washout percent more than 40%. MR characterization depends on chemical shift artifact and detect the loss of signal on out of phase. But MRI has no capability to detect characterized lesion, which is lipid poor adenoma. In these cases, we need to do a PET CT, which is high sensitivity in detection of malignant lesion and show high uptake of FDG by the benign adenoma, by metastasis. Hemorrhage and necrosis within the metastasis also result in a false negative FDG uptake. Some benign lesion will cause a high positive, false positive uptake of FDG.
Wait. Hemorrhage and necrosis, metastasis will cause
false negative. Yes. Well, normally
you do a PET, it will be negative, but it's not negative, it's a metastasis.
Yes.
While what else?
Other inflammatory lesion, infectious disease may cause a high uptake, so result in false positive in 5% of cases. Lesion small than 1 centimeter, usually difficult to characterize, and some SUV greater than 3.1 correlate with malignancy, and usually we should compare the uptake of the lesion with the uptake of the liver. If it is higher, it is raised possibility of malignant tumor. Standard uptake of uptake value. Yes. CT guided adrenal biopsy is safe with the risk of hemorrhage and pneumothorax is usually unusual complication, and the biopsy performed with transhepatic approach with decubitus position with adrenal lesion down side down to diminish risk of pneumothorax. Percutaneous biopsy of pheochromocytoma should be avoided as it precipitates risk of hypertensive crisis. Here are the questions that how to calculate the absolute and the relative percentage washout. This is a case of adrenal metastasis showing this mass measuring 6 by 5 cm, replacing the left adrenal gland. The mass is irregular in shape and there is some surrounding extent to the adjacent tissue. This is a case of adrenal adenoma. This is of lipid poor adrenal adenoma because it is show 16 Hausfeld unit on non-contrast CT. Contrast CT showing Hausfeld unit of 41. Delay after 10 to 15 minutes is done and showing relative washout of more than 53% and absolute washout of 88%. So this will prove this is adrenal adenoma, benign adrenal adenoma. PET CT showing high uptake of the FDG by left adrenal mass in comparison to the liver, it is higher uptake, so it is adrenal metastasis. Adrenal endocrine syndrome, Cushing syndrome, is caused by excessive hydrocortisone and corticosterone level. 70% of cases due to adrenal hyperplasia, and the other 10% due to adrenal carcinoma, 20% due to adrenal adenoma. The most common cause of adrenal hyperplasia is due to pituitary microadenoma, so examination of the pituitary gland by MRI should be done in these cases, and other 10% caused by ectopic production of ACTH by by some lesions such as lung cancer. Subclinical form of Cushing syndrome has been associated with the presence of a small adrenal adenoma that found incidentally. It may more common than the classical Cushing syndrome. Cohen syndrome, produced by elevated level of aldosterone and cause 1 to 2% of systemic hypertension. It appears as solitary benign hyperfunctioning adrenal adenoma. Usually it is less than 2 cm in size. And citric attention should be done to, by multi-detector CT using thin slices to detect the accurate localization of the adenoma. And adrenal venous sampling may be done to confirm the site of excess aldosterone secretion and to differentiate whether it is adenoma or hyperplasia. It is in 80% it is due to adrenal adenoma and 20% due to adrenal hyperplasia. 20% due to adrenal hyperplasia and 80% due to adrenal adenoma. Adrenogenital syndrome occurs in infant and a newborn baby and due to deficiency of cortisol and aldosterone.
So, Cushing syndrome usually due to adrenal hyperplasia.
Yes.
While Cohen syndrome usually due to
adrenal adenoma. Yes. This infant usually have with adrenogenital syndrome have adrenal hyperplasia, which is discovered easily on ultrasound. Adrenal adenoma and carcinoma may be the cause of muscularizing and feminizing syndrome in older patients. Addison syndrome occurs due to adrenal insufficiency, and usually the adrenal gland is small in size, cannot be detected on imaging method, and additional cause could mostly due to autoimmune disease, could be caused by other causes such as tuberculosis, histoplasmosis. In these cases, usually there's calcification of the adrenal gland. Bilateral enlargement is seen with active infection, lymphoma, metastasis that replace the gland with a tumor. Pheochromocytoma is a rare catechol immune secreting tumor. It usually follows the rule of 10. 10% is bilateral, 10% extra-adrenal, 10% malignant, 10% familial, and 10% detected incidentally. It is associated with other syndromes such as MEN2, von Hippel-Lindau syndrome, and neurofibromatosis. It is high at risk of spontaneous hemorrhage. CT method of choice for detecting the tumor. And use of intravenous contrast media is contraindicated in a patient it causes a precipitate adrenergic crisis.
Traditionally advised against contrast.
Yes.
Yes. Before,
but
they were
use
saying
of non-ionic.
Don't
yes.
Do contrast examination in patients with suspected
pheochromocytoma. Yes. Yes.
The recent
more recent
studies,
yes.
Update
yes.
Suggests that there is no
risk with non-ionic contrast media.
So we can do it. We don't
yes.
have to be worried about it.
Yes. A tumor vary purely from purely solid to complex or predominantly cystic lesion. Calcification is seen but rarely as it appears eggshell calcification and tumor enhance evenly and wash out slowly, unlike adenoma that show rapid wash out. On MRI, it gives on T2 light bulb appearance and chemical shift MRI show no change in signal intensity between in phase and out of phase. If no lesion is found in the adrenal gland, scanning it should be extended to the pelvis and chest to show if there is extra adrenal pheochromocytoma. The most common site is at the bifurcation of the aorta, bladder, and para-aortic sympathetic chain. Radionuclear study is effective in localizing pheochromocytoma. PET CT show an increased FDG in cases that is negative on radionuclear study.
It's helping to look for extra adrenal. Sometimes it takes MIT, and this will result in detection. If it is negative, then you try again.
This is incidental pheochromocytoma found in patient after RTA, showing this left adrenal mass, and on clinical evaluation, this proved to be a pheochromocytoma. This is another case of pheochromocytoma with a spontaneous hemorrhage into the perinephric space, showing the inferior vena cava and the aorta displaced anteriorly. This is a case of extra-adrenal bladder pheochromocytoma, showing see in the bladder wall. On T2 weighted MRI demonstrate lobulated mass within the posterior wall of the bladder.
People with pheochromocytoma diagnosed incidentally.
Yes.
Usually, this person, they say, this is a crazy person. He always bursts into anger. Well, who bursts into anger? It was just adrenaline.
Catecholamine
release. Adrenaline. They call it cytoma. Okay. يعني هو قاعد عادي ما عنده أي مشكلة فجأة بسرعة عصبي ويضرب وكذا أو يصير palpitation يصير سوين هو is not crazy it's just having undiagnosed pheochromocytoma that's it.
Benign adrenal hyperplasia. Adrenal hyperplasia is a cause of, as I say, Cushing syndrome in 70% and Cone's syndrome in 20%. It is important to differentiate whether it is adenoma or hyperplasia. Half of cases of adrenal hyperplasia show normal MR and CT study. Uncommonly, hyperplasia may appear as nodular and may mimic solitary or multiple adenoma. In diffuse hyperplasia, the length of the adrenal gland is longer than 5 cm and exceeds 10 millimeter thickness. Chemical shift MR occasionally show loss of signal on opposed phase. Metastatic disease, tuberculosis, histoplasmosis may cause diffuse adrenal enlargement and can mimic appearance of adrenal hyperplasia. Adrenal myelolipoma, it is a rare tumor. It's a non-functioning benign tumor arising from a bone marrow element in the adrenal gland and it may reach a large size up to 30 centimeters. Calcification seen in 20% of cases. Identification of the region of macroscopic fat, minus 30 to minus 100 has filled in within the tumor on CT and MRI is definitive to make the diagnosis. CT attenuation less than 30 Hausfeld unit is definitive. On MRI show high signal intensity, high signal fat on T1 and on T2 and fat saturation pulse sequence showing a decreased signal confirmed the diagnosis. Chemical shift artifact is usually not useful as it, the macroscopic fat has little intracellular water. PET typically show no avid FDG uptake on ultrasound. These are extremely echogenic and blend with the retroperitoneal fat. This is adrenal myelolipoma between these two within the of the left adrenal gland and with large anterior internal fat density similar to the retroperitoneal fat. Adrenal hemorrhage, the most common cause in infant, usually induced by episode of hypoxia, blunt trauma, or septicemia. Mostly it is bilateral. In children, the adrenal hemorrhage may be associated with child abuse. In adult, blunt trauma in 80% and infection are most common causes of adrenal hemorrhage. Unilateral hemorrhage is most occur in adult and more on the right side. Bilateral hemorrhage causes adrenal insufficiency. On unenhanced CT, hemorrhage show high attenuation 50 to 90% Hausfeld unit. Hemorrhage on CT is hypodense compared with the liver and the spleen on contrast enhanced study and with showing stranding of the pre-adrenal fat and thickening of the adjacent fascia are additional finding. MRI is highly sensitive and specific to detect adrenal hemorrhage. Acute hemorrhage appear is iso-intense to, on T1 and low intensity on T2. Subacute appear bright on T1 and variable on T2. Old hemorrhage usually is due to hemosiderin appear dark on both T1 and T2. Ultrasound appear as hypoechoic mass that shrink and less echogenic over time. This is a case of adrenal hemorrhage. The adrenal gland following trauma. The adrenal gland is compressed between the liver and the spine, and this is the myeloma within the liver. Adrenal calcification occurs both in children and adults. The most common cause is the adrenal hemorrhage. Tuberculosis, histoplasmosis are other cause of adrenal calcification associated with Addison's disease. Adrenal tumor may calcify, including neuroblastoma, ganglionuroma, and pheochromocytoma. Adrenal pseudocyst, attributed to previous hemorrhage, is the most common cause of calcified adrenal mass in adults. Wolman disease is autosomal recessive lipid disorder associated with adrenal bilateral adrenal enlargement and calcification with hepatosplenomegaly. Bilateral adrenal calcification, brain radiograph in a child 4 years old. There is calcification of both adrenal gland result from bilateral adrenal hemorrhage. Adrenal cyst is classified into true cyst or pseudocyst according to the endothelial lining of the cyst. Also, there is parasitic cyst that is adrenococcal in origin. Adrenal cyst usually more common in female, and uncomplicated cyst usually have thin wall less than 3 millimeter without calcification, and internal water density don't exceed 5 to 6 centimeter in size. No internal enhancement on CT. Ultrasound usually showing thin walls. an echoic cyst, and usually on MRI of low intensity on T1, high intensity on T2, no internal enhancement with gadolinium. Calcification in the cyst and septa is a common finding in all type of cyst. And endothelial cysts tend to be multilocular. Hemorrhagic pseudocyst is usually unilocular with calcification in the wall. Cysts larger than 6 cm have thick wall and solid component and show internal contrast enhancement. On CT, it is non-homogeneous. On CT and MRI, it is non-homogeneous on MRI. And echogenic fluid or internal debris may be seen on ultrasound that, that produce symptoms. And surgical removal of these cysts is indicated. A percutaneous biopsy of the cyst wall of the cyst wall is difficult, and a percutaneous aspiration of the cyst fluid may not be reliable to exclude malignancy. This is a case of post-hemorrhagic adrenal cyst, show well-defined cystic lesion with calcification in the septa and the wall. Ganglioneuroma is a rare benign tumor of adrenal medulla and or pre-vertebral sympathetic chain. Most even when large are asymptomatic. Imaging usually show homogeneous, very larger than 20 cm mass with heterogeneous enhancement. And adrenal carcinoma, usually it is a lethal tumor, mostly larger than 6 cm and invasive at presentation. Typical CT appearance is large tumor 4 to 20 cm with area of central necrosis and hemorrhage. And adrenal tumor larger than 4 to 5 cm should be removed because of significant risk of any adrenal tumor larger than 4 to 5 cm should be removed as there is significant risk of carcinoma. Calcification occurs in 30% of this tumor. Hepatic and lymph node metastases are common, and invasion of the renal vein and inferior vena cava may be evident. On MRI, on T1, it is appear as non-homogeneous large mass, predominantly hypo-intense compared with the liver, and it is of increased signal intensity on T2. Ultrasound and Doppler are excellent in evaluation of the tumor thrombosis. PET-CT show marked FDG avidity. Is a case of adrenal carcinoma, T2 weighted MRI showing high signal intensity mass, replacing the right adrenal. Difficult.
You just have to remove it and see, or biopsy it at least.
Lymphoma is a rare primary adrenal tumor, and usually it is non-Hodgkin in 4% of cases. Retroperitoneal lymphoma may encase the gland. On CT, usually show washout characteristics similar to malignancy. And on MRI, show heterogeneous bright signal on T2. PET-CT show increased FDG uptake. Collagen tumor is referred to coexistent of a histologically distinct neoplasm that exists separately in same region, as metastatic disease may be deposited on previously characterized adrenal adenoma. An increase in the size of the lesion or change in the imaging character so suggests this rare lesion.
So you have two tumors in the same gland,
yes,
in the same patient at the same time.
Kidney imaging method that is used, as the first of all, is the CT IVU, which replaced the use of traditional IVU. And traditional IVU, also we have MRI urogram that is used for investigation. Ultrasound, also color Doppler ultrasound, is valuable in assessment of tumor vascularity and extension of the tumor into the venous system. Anatomy, the kidney is located within the cone of the renal fascia, gerota fascia, surrounded by fat of the perirenal space. Usually the kidney measuring 9 to 13 centimeters in size, and increase in size from birth till to age of 20. From 20 to 50 years, it is stable in size and gradually decrease in size thereafter. Simple calyx, usually cup shape, and that drain one renal loop. Compound calyx, usually located at the upper pole of the kidney, at the upper pole of the kidney, and usually drain more than one loop. The main renal artery usually originates laterally from the aorta, just below the origin of the supramesenteric artery. There is tight fibrous capsule that cover the kidney, produce sharp renal margin on CT. Perirenal fat continue into the renal sinus, outlining the blood vessels and collecting system. This is normal. This is IVU of showing the left kidney with normal excretion of contrast. And this is normal cup-shaped calyx. on the lower pole, and this calyx is compound calyx at the upper pole, and this is the coronal plane reconstructed pyelogram face CT urogram from CT urogram. Congenital renal anomaly include renal agenesis, which is usually associated with genital tract abnormality, mostly in female. FC lateral adrenal agenesis in 10% of cases, and abnormal, compensatory hyperatrophy of the other kidney is usually seen. Horse show kidney is the most common effusion anomaly of the kidney. Usually the lower pole are joined across the midline by fibrous or parenchymal band, and usually it is a lower position than normal due to failure to ascend due to the presence of the inferior mesenteric vessel, and the renal artery frequently multiple and ectopic in origin. The midline isthmus is identified on cross-sectional imaging. Across the fuse, renal ectopia may be present as abdominal mass of two kidney, that is the ureter of the crossed kidney is usually implanted on the normal size. On yes, about 40% risk of carcinoma higher than other. Yes, warms the tumor. Yes. Renal artery in cross-fused ectopia, it's invariably aberrant, and demonstration of the ureter insert into the normal location in the bladder trigone confirms the diagnosis. This is a case of horse show kidney and showing this isthmus across the midline, and it is also low in position. It failed to ascend due to the presence of the inferior mesenteric vessel.
What you need to report in every horse show kidney is that are they connected by renal parenchyma or by fibrous tissue, because the surgery will be a little bit different if it is renal parenchyma, if in surgery.
Yes.
Most of the time it doesn't require surgery, but in case you need to report.
Yes. Solid renal mass, renal cell carcinoma account about 85% of all renal neoplasm, and most common in men, more common in male, about 5-1 male to female, and occur at present at age of 50 to 70 years. Predisposing condition include von Hippel-Lindau syndrome, disease, hereditary papillary renal cell acquired renal cystic disease associated with long-term dialysis, cigarette smoking, renal transplantation, HIV infection, and other predisposing factor. Most tumor is solitary at presentation, and 6% is multifocal, 4% is bilateral. Any solid renal mass should be considered and suspect renal cell carcinoma. Hemorrhage and necrosis and cystic are common. Cystic, cystic and multicystic form 5-10% of cases. An important radiological feature showing an extension of the tumor beyond the gerota capsule and invasion of the vessel should be, all this should be detected by CT and MRI. Also distant metastasis and CT of the chest and the brain should be done. Avid heterogeneous enhancement of the tumor with seen with clear cell carcinoma, while papillary and chlorophobe tumor show lesser degree of enhancement. A tumor is usually hypo-intense to the renal parenchyma on non-contrast CT and showing heterogeneous enhancement, heterogeneous low enhancement post-contrast. CT is not accurate in differentiating stage 1 from stage 2, and it is of limited treatment significance. And stranding density into the perineal fat could be due to edema or fibrosis from a previous inflammation, and not usually from, not always from extension of the tumor.
So it's important to detect nodules in the perineal fat.
Yes.
Because this will change treatment strategy. Otherwise, it's not significant.
Yes.
If it's stage 1, if it's stage 2,
the same treatment.
If there's no stranding,
yes,
it doesn't matter.
Yes. Also, detection of thrombus within the inferior vena cava is important to detect if there is any metastasis, malignant thrombus. Cystic and multilocular cyst form of renal cell carcinoma are Bosniak 3 or 4 lesion, characterized by nodular thickening of the wall and septa that enhance with contrast. On MRI, renal cell carcinoma is usually iso-intense or slightly hypo-intense compared with renal parenchyma. And on T2, it appears heterogeneous. heterogeneous reflecting area of necrosis and hemorrhage, also hemosiderin. Also papillary renal cell carcinoma tend to be hypo-intense on both T1 and T2 and show low-level homogeneous enhancement post-contrast. Ultrasound showing the solid renal cell carcinoma as heterogeneous hypoechoic or mildly hyperechoic mass. Area of hemorrhage and necrosis appear cystic. Doppler ultrasound of the renal vein and inferior vena cava show tumor thrombus. This is a case of renal cell carcinoma appear as exophytic lesion extending from the lateral aspect of the tumor with area of central necrosis and hemorrhage. Another case of cystic renal cell carcinoma, the lesion is usually show thick wall, shaggy appearance, indistinct surrounding into indistinct surrounding extending into the perirenal fat. Another case of multicystic renal carcinoma, contrast enhanced, showing low attenuation, well-defined mass with enhancement of the septa, and this is on an ultrasound of the same patient, showing mass that projects from the lateral aspect of the left kidney. This coronal plane image of MRI showing MR angiogram showing there is a mass replacing the upper pole of the right kidney, and there is a tumor extend into the inferior vena cava and renal vein. Angiomyolipoma is an uncommon, occur in 1-3% of renal neoplasm. About 80% of the tumor is solitary. It's more common in the middle-aged women. Most above the tumor, 20%, that is multiple lesion seen in patients with tuberous sclerosis. Because of abnormal thin wall vessel and angiomyolipoma prone to hemorrhage, large solitary lesions are usually surgically removed. Imaging study reflect the tissue composition to nearly homogeneous solid muscle density. A tumor may be larger as large as 20 centimeters and may be predominantly exophytic mimic renal non-renal tumor. Multi-detector CT showing detection of fat density within the solid renal tumor is a high indication of angiomyolipoma, while detection of fat density in a solid renal lesion with calcification, this is high risk of renal cell carcinoma. MR diagnosis also has been made on demonstration of fat within the tumor and decrease in signal intensity in fat containing area on fat saturation, fat suppression image is most reliable finding. Chemical shift MR may demonstrate the characteristic Indian ink artifact at the interface between the tumor and normal renal parenchyma. يعني هو chemical shift artifact that's detected on
shift.
Yes,
but it appears very dark line
yes
between the interface
between normal renal tissue and the angiomyolipoma. The presence of central necrosis is important to differentiate renal cell carcinoma from lipid poor adenoma. Also, renal cell carcinoma may contain intracellular fat, but macroscopic fat, a characteristic of AML, has been reported in renal cell carcinoma only in the presence of calcification. Ultrasound characteristics demonstrate a hyperechoic solid mass and echogenicity of the tumor often exceed the renal sinus fat because renal cell carcinoma less than 3 cm in size may appear also as echogenic mass so that the overlap the ultrasound appearance of AML, this lesion must be definitively characterized by CT and MRI.
So when you see a hyperechoic lesion by ultrasound,
need further investigation.
You cannot just say angiomyolipoma and send patient home.
Yes. Echogenic. Yes. It's a case of angiomyolipoma post-contrast CT showing a tumor infiltrating the left kidney, and the density of this lesion is equal to the density of the perirenal fat. Oncocytoma, this is a rare tumor, occur in 3-6% of renal neoplasm, usually occur in older age group, and it is if large tumor, it demonstrates central scar, and MRI show low signal intensity on T1, high signal intensity on T2, difficult to differentiate from renal cell carcinoma, so it has the same treatment, it should be removed to confirm the diagnosis.
Oncocytoma cannot be differentiated from renal cell carcinoma.
Yes.
You have to remove or to biopsy. Even by biopsy. Sometimes it's not pathological.
Cannot be differentiated, yes. lymphoma, although it is a renal primary renal lymphoma, is rare. The kidney is commonly involved by metastatic lymphoma, as it is usually non-Hodgkin type, and pattern of involvement could be diffuse, enlarging the kidney, or multiple bilateral solid renal tumors, solitary bulky tumor, or pre-renal tumor surrounding the kidney. Or a tumor invasion of from the retroperitoneal into the renal sinus. CT show lymphoma as homogeneous, poorly enhancing extensive retroperitoneal adenopathy favored diagnosis. On MRI, lymphoma appear hypointense on T1 and T2 and show minimal heterogeneous enhancement. Metastasis, the kidney is a frequent size of metastasis, most commonly come from the lung. Lung, breast, colon, carcinoma, and melanoma. It appear as multiple or bilateral, small, irregular, infiltrative renal mass, and difficult to differentiate also from the renal cell carcinoma. This is a case of renal lymphoma showing infiltrate the perirenal space partially surrounding the both kidney. Metastasis to the kidney in patient with non-lung cancer. Showing this hypodense lesion within the right kidney. Renal cystic disease, it is either simple renal cystic disease that most common renal mass, and it occur over, usually in a patient over 55 years old, and large cyst more than 4 centimeters, usually small asymptomatic, large cyst more than 4 centimeter, usually commonly multiple and bilateral. Ultrasound criteria usually as rounded or oval, an echoic mass of an increased thorough transmission, sharply defined far wall, and thin imperceptible cyst wall. On CT, it appear of low density between 0 to 10 Hodgkin's units.
Yes.
An MRI, low T1 and high T2. Complicated cyst could be due to infected normal, يعني simple renal cyst or hemorrhagic cyst, or due to cystic degeneration of a tumor. The Bosnia classification usually based on CT criteria. Category 1 is it is similar to any simple cyst. Category 2 should show one of the three criteria. First, a cyst with delicate thin septa, not more than 1 to 2 millimeter thickness. Second, a cyst with delicate thin calcification in the wall or septum, or third, showing high density cyst, large, higher than 60 to 100 Hausfeld unit, because it could be due to high protein content or due to hemorrhage, and usually show high signal intensity on T1 and low signal intensity on T2. Category 2F, which we need follow-up, and those are very likely benign but require additional follow-up. It appear as a thick cyst with thick nodular calcification in the wall, and in the wall that is included in this category. Also, this cyst with thin septa or minimal smooth thickening of the wall also need follow-up. Intrarenal non-enhancing high-density cyst more than 3 centimeter. Also regarded as Bosniak 2F. This lesion needed follow-up at 3, 6, and 12 months. Bosniak 3 are indeterminate lesion and difficult to differentiate whether it is benign or malignant. And the finding is a thick irregular calcification with irregular margin, thick enhancing septa, area of nodularity, thick wall, and multinodular mass. Category 4 mass, it is clearly malignant, and malignant necrotic cystic neoplasm or tumor that arise in the wall of the cyst. CT and MRI demonstration of enhancement of solid area following contrast administration make diagnosis of malignancy. And a small renal lesion may be particularly difficult to calcify, so thin slice CT scan with bolus contrast enhancement and great attention to the detail will assist in the correct classification of the lesion. Renal abscess, other causes of renal cyst, cystic disease is the renal abscess, which usually follow pyelonephritis complicated by liquefactive necrosis. Other as renal cell carcinoma appear as predominantly cystic lesion. Multinodular cystic nephroma, which is called adult cystic nephroma, it is uncommon benign neoplasm and difficult classified also as Bosniak 3 or 4, and usually discovered most commonly in middle age women 40 to 60 years, and in male child between 3 months to 4 years.
So multinodular cystic nephroma is usually benign in women.
Yes.
Okay.
This is simple renal cyst, large cyst arising from the right kidney. Another case of complicated renal cyst, post contrast showing wall enhancement.
More common in female, it is a benign tumor. I'm not saying it's
female.
So more in female, usually it's a benign tumor.
This is a case of a renal abscess, the right adrenal, right renal abscess. This is a thick, thick wall and enhancing septa. Renal cystic disease, autosomal recessive polycystic disease, usually manifests later in life between 30 to 50 years, and about 60% of these patients have liver. Autosomal dominant polycystic kidney. In children, yes. Between 30 to 50 years old, usually there's demonstration of cyst in the liver by 60% of patient, and pancreatic cyst in 10% of patient. There is also extra renal manifestation, include cardiovascular abnormality, CT showing innumerable cyst that is of variable size and shape, as in this case, showing bilateral kidney renal enlargement and replacement of the normal renal parenchyma by cysts of different size and shape.
And you can see the liver cysts also.
Yes.
Multiple liver cysts.
Yes. Yeah. Multiple simple cysts must be differentiated from adult polycystic disease, and usually occur in patient older age group. Usually it is fewer cysts and a simple cyst. Von Hippel-Lindau syndrome is a rare inherited disease characterized by multiple renal cysts, and some of them may develop renal cell carcinoma of multicystic type in 24 to 45% of cases. Associated lesions include renal angioma and cerebral hemangioblastoma. Tuberous sclerosis combine multiple renal cysts and multiple angiomyolipoma with cutaneous and retinal cerebral hematoma. Acquired uremic cystic disease due to long-term hemodialysis, the patient develop multiple cysts, and the incidence increase usually after 5 to 10 years of hemodialysis. Also, they are at risk of developing renal cell carcinoma in 7% of cases. This is acquired uremic cystic disease. Both kidney are usually reveal both kidney small and contain numerous cystic lesions after 8 years of the hemodialysis. Autosomal recessive polycystic kidney, it usually develop in neonate and infant. This patient usually have liver fibrosis. Usually it is inversely related to the severity of the renal involvement. So the disease range from infantile polycystic disease with massive renal fibrosis to juvenile polycystic disease with minimal renal fibrosis. Ultrasound feature showing liver fibrosis. Ultrasound showing there is multiple cysts less than 5 millimeters in size, and children usually showing severe renal disease when develop a larger cyst. And in older children who develop liver disease, ultrasound show enlarged echogenic liver and cystic dilatation of the intrahepatic biliary duct. Portal hypertension, splenomegaly also may develop.
So it's either in children, in infants, or in children, older,
yes,
little bit older age group.
Juvenile.
Has the severity, according to the severity. When it's severe in both. When it's mild in both. Kidney and liver. Yani either mild in the kidney and liver or severe in the kidney and liver.
No, inversely related.
It's mild in liver.
Okay.
Inversely related.
Inversely
related.
Mild, severe,
yes,
or severe mild. Okay.
Yes.
And they might develop liver fibrosis later on and end
yes,
up with portal hypertension
and splenomegaly.
Yeah.
Autosomal recessive polycystic disease on ultrasound and on a CT scan showing enlargement of both kidneys. We cannot see the cyst.
They are too small to be seen.
Yes. Medullary sponge kidney is usually referred to dysplastic dilatation of the collecting system. Most patients are asymptomatic and is usually bilateral symmetrical. Sometimes it may be focal and unilateral or asymmetrical. It causes striation or circular contrast collection in the papillae on CT and MRI. The patient also at risk of developing stone formation due to stasis of the urine. Uremic medullary cyst, it is due to patient also on renal with renal problem. This cyst usually small in size, difficult to detect medullary cyst, and by this current imaging method. multicystic dysplastic kidney usually diagnosed in utero at birth, and usually the kidney appear as a mass of non-communicating cysts of variable size. With time, the kidney progressively atrophy, and in adult appear as nubin of tissue, and also the urethra is atrophic. Yes. Renal vascular disease, the most common renal vascular disease, arteriovenous malformation, which is due to which appear on CT as
IVM or IVM?
Yes.
Congenital, IVF acquired.
Yes, congenital is more common than acquired more common than congenital, mostly iatrogenic. Doppler ultrasound show nest of vessel with mixed color turbulence, and MRI angiography is less sensitive for flow for slow flow lesion, but effectively demonstrate feeding vessel of high flow lesion.
And high flow, we can see it by MRI.
Yes.
Slow flow, it's
difficult.
Not good for
yes. Renal artery venous malformation. Seen on coronal plane CT angiogram. This showing large vessel within the right kidney and enlarged supplying artery and vein. Renal infection, acute pyelonephritis. It is usually the CT is more sensitive than ultrasound for detection of acute pyelonephritis. It is usually need no imaging study if it is not complicated. CT is normal in most of patient. Inflammatory low density mass may be seen within the mass. It's called lobar nephronia, and the complication of acute pyelonephritis include intrarenal or perirenal abscess, and MRI and CT scan should be done for these complicated cases. Acute pyelonephritis showing edema and swelling associated with acute renal infection cause wedge shape infarction. This is the arrowhead within the kidney. Perirenal abscess, contrast enhanced CT, dislocate a low density. Disclose a low density fluid collection surrounding the kidney. Yes. Emphysematous pyelonephritis is a form of acute acute pyelonephritis. Most cases occur in a diabetic patient due to obstruction or immune compression. Emphysematous pyelonephritis, it's a very dangerous emphysematous pyelonephritis is a very dangerous case. Emphysematous pyelitis is referred to infection with gas but confined to the renal collecting system but sparing the renal parenchyma.
Emphysematous pyelonephritis
less aggressive.
Gas within the renal parenchyma.
Yes.
Emphysematous pyelitis with the gas. And the
collecting system,
only,
yes.
Pyelonephritis is life-threatening. Pyelitis,
less aggressive. A chronic pyelonephritis with reflux nephropathy usually occur in children with vesico-uretric reflux of infected urine is the most common cause. The hallmark of is the cortical scar that overlie blunted calyx. CT and MRI showing also the same feature. This is a case of emphysematous pyelonephritis, conventional radiograph showing striation. Xanthogranulomatous pyelonephritis is a rare destructive granulomatous condition.
Stone, stag horn,
yes.
With a chronic
obstruction,
infection,
yes.
Forming a mass-like lesion of
yes.
inflammatory tissue, destroying the kidney.
Yes.
That's called xanthogranulomatous pyelonephritis.
Non-functioning kidney. Yes. Here, this is a stag horn kidney and non-functioning kidney. Failure to excrete contrast. Renal tuberculosis occur in a patient with history of a previous infection and 30% of patients showing abnormal chest radiograph with prior tuberculosis. It is only occur in 10% of cases of
renal TB.
Active
renal,
TB.
It's the most common site of extrathoracic TB.
Yes.
Most of the cases will not show any evidence of thoracic TB. Of
only
10%
show active pulmonary tuberculosis.
Okay.
Yes.
Will cause the kidney to be destroyed, calcified, irregular, non-functioning.
Yes.
Next. Like this one.
This in the stage renal tuberculosis, calcified, non-functioning, renal kidney. Yes. Renal parenchymal disease, renal failure. Usually, ultrasound should be done to detect if there's hydronephrosis and assess renal size and to identify parenchymal disease. Usually, patient with a small kidney less than 9 centimeter have irreversible end-stage renal disease. And measurement of the renal cortical thickness is not reliable in assessing residual renal function. Sonographic finding showing an increase in the parenchymal echogenicity, often associated with loss of the corticomedullary differentiation. HIV renal disease. We have many disease caused by HIV, HIV nephropathy and infection, Kaposi sarcoma and lymphoma. And also anti-retroviral therapy may cause stone that is not appear on...
Lindinavir is the only one that causes a stone
that not detected on CT scan. Yes, like HIV nephropathy. And lastly, nephrocalcinosis, which is a broad term referred to pathological deposition of calcium in the renal parenchyma. Either it is cortical or medullary nephrocalcinosis. This is a case of... Yes, more common. This is a case of bilateral medullary nephrocalcinosis, unconventional radiography. In patient of renal dysfunction, yes. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, it's a big subject, and I hope we covered it.